Our guest on ANN is Patricia Parker, founder of Kids for Kids, a charity working in Sudan. With Patricia, we will talk about the humanitarian crisis in Sudan, the work of Kids for Kids, and the whole refugee issue. Well, welcome back to the English Hour on ANN Television. Our guest this week is Patricia Parker. Patricia is founder of Kids for Kids. Patricia, welcome to ANN. Welcome to the English
Good
Hour.
Good morning. Thank
well,
you.
Thank you. I should say, I mean, you're Patricia Parker, you're founder of Kids for Kids. Our guests, our viewers, don't actually know what Kids for Kids is, but it's a wonderful charity that works primarily in Sudan, and we're going to hear all about it. Indeed, you were given the MBE, weren't you, by Her Majesty the Queen, so you're one of our great ones in Britain.
Oh dear, but I'm afraid that was nothing to do with Kids for Kids. I don't know that anyone would do that sort of thing for helping children in Darfur. It's a forgotten region, so, you know, it's not one's not looking for something like that there. In fact, seeing your beautiful rose, it was the Fields of Hope for Marie Curie Cancer Care that I started. That actually made me,
Good
as a volunteer,
heavens.
I was honoured by the Queen.
It
was amazing.
Well, wonderful. Well, we're here to talk about Sudan and your work in Sudan. What we will do, we'll go, as is our custom on ANN, we'll go to a short introductory video package and then we'll go straight back to our discussion.
Great.
Thank you. Environmental degradation and competition over resources is one of the principal causes of communal conflict in Darfur. But the ongoing carnage is also the product of a long history of ethnic marginalization and manipulation by Sudan's ruling elites. Mix this with a staggering 46.5% of the population below the poverty line. As the conflict in Darfur rages on, sporadic violence appears to be the norm. Despite the establishment of a joint UN and AU peacekeeping command called UNAMID in 2007, there is still no stability in the country. Some 2 million people have been displaced. In 2014, 3,300 villages were destroyed. Sexual violence rose significantly, with resource competition for water and other natural resources reaching an all-time high. The charity known as Kids for Kids focuses on the needs of local communities in Darfur. Kids for Kids supports grassroots projects that communities identify as the most effective way of enabling them to help themselves. The first priority is creating a clean water source. Other projects include the training of midwives, provision of donkeys, veterinary care, training in farm techniques, and the provision of blankets. An extensive tree planting campaign has been funded by Kids for Kids, whilst a new midwives training school in El Fasher, the provincial capital, has resulted in the training of 40 village midwives each year. With the current Mediterranean immigrant crisis in the media spotlight, refugees from war-torn and impoverished areas are desperate to risk their lives to come into Europe. It is imperative that British and European policymakers tackle the root causes of this migrationary pattern. The UK is the second largest aid donor in Sudan after the USA. Okay. So Patricia, thank you again. Sudan, we will talk about Kids for Kids and your wonderful work there, but let's kind of set the scene, because Sudan is such a precious country. I know it well, but from when I was much younger, I used to go often in Numeri's day when he was president. and it's a place I cherish and love. I have many happy memories, but it's not such a happy place now, largely because of the humanitarian catastrophe that Sudan is facing. Can you maybe tell us a little about the crisis that Sudan is in?
Of course, but I think you're right to say how attached to Sudan people become when they visit. It's not because of the country. When people look at pictures of my beautiful green garden in Surrey, they say, what are you doing in Darfur? And I have to say, if I look at the sand and the devastation and the encroaching Sahara, I would say, I don't know, because green Surrey suits me better. Look at my colouring. Mm. But actually, it's the people of Sudan. The Sudanese are a very special people. And I'm actually heartbroken because I haven't been given a visa now since October 2011. So. But I'm very privileged because I have this wonderful team in Darfur who are actually sending me photographs every day of our projects. I know exactly what is going on in our villages and, as you say, with the humanitarian problems in Darfur. Interestingly, you said primarily in Sudan for Kids for Kids. And when I'm in Sudan, people will say to me, why only Darfur, Patricia? And I think it's very important to put Darfur in context. We, the wise British and the Egyptians and so on, created Sudan into a huge area. Frankly, I would believe an ungovernable area. It's so vast.
It was a million square miles, wasn't it? The largest
absolutely.
Country in Africa.
And Darfur is the size of France. Imagine that. Colossal, a country in its own right. The British took it over in 1916. It was a kingdom before that. So the Darfurians are a mixed a group of people, different tribes and so on. And there's referral, as you know, to tribal conflict. And I feel that's really not understood as what is happening. The tribal conflict back in 2001, when I was first there, happened when Arab tribesmen who were nomads with their vast herds of cattle and camel would come south. Because of their animals following the grass as the heat becomes unbearable and the grass just turns to sand again. But of course, if they come south and they come at the wrong times too early, there are crops still growing. And the tribal conflict was actually very small scale. It would be when a herd has gone onto someone's farmland and obviously there's an altercation. And there were really good tribal systems in place to settle those conflicts. And the terrible tragedy since what we now call the conflict broke out in 2003 is that those tribal strengths have been absolutely undermined. Not only undermined by the violence itself, for example, when people have fled to the vast camps, and of course they're still there, often the humanitarian aid agencies have unknowingly undermined the authorities of the tribal leaders because they've worked through young, energetic men. And these youngsters, because they're in control of the vouchers, the money and so on, are actually the ones that people now go to rather than the tribal leaders with their wisdom. So it's a lot of things that are pulling against
each
other. There
is the situation, there's so many dimensions to this. The situation in Darfur, was it partly global warming that has caused this? The shortage of grass and the shortage of grazing, and you have this nomad population, as you rightly say, coming south. Are the farmers themselves? They are indigenous. They're not themselves migrants.
No, they're indigenous people who have lived there for countless years. And people sometimes say to me, "Well, why don't they move away? If you can't farm the land, if there's not water, water is the key to everything. If you can't reach water, why don't they move away? Where would you move to?" You would become like the refugees all over the world. You need to stay at home. And actually, I'm realising more and more, the things that I've been doing with Kids for Kids since I started the charity have turned out to be far bigger than I could ever have imagined. What we're actually doing is enabling people to stay in their own homes. Young men to build up their own farmland, to marry, to settle, to stay in their own country. which is what we all want. You know, one of my sons is down in Devon, quite away from me, but actually I can get there, it's the same country. The same thing in Sudan, in Darfur, in Red Sea, in Blue Nile and so on. People want to stay where their homes are, their families are.
So these populations, I mean, you're talking about nomadic Arabs, Arabs in the sense of being Arabic-speaking nomads that we would understand, and the farming population, they're Arabic-speaking as well?
There are many dialects, but actually my son, who's a diplomat, he was the reason I went to Sudan originally, son going abroad, it's an Arabic-based language. So even when it's the Berties and so on, Alistair can understand what's being said and
is understanding
his turn. So that, you know, these are not... There hasn't been a real tribal hate situation until now, where it's really becoming very fragmented and very difficult. It needs to be solved in Darfur.
Both groups are Muslim?
Yeah, absolutely.
So you're talking about absolutely. An inter-Muslim conflict.
Yeah. And remember, when I was first there, everybody called themselves Sudanese. Sudanese first,
yes.
Darfurian next, and then their tribe third. Mm-hmm. Now I'm not so sure.
So this tragedy, and of course everybody's armed, and the problem with arms is you can never bring them back once arms are dispersed to the entire population.
Well,
so there's a lot of violence. Amongst
the farmers and the families, they're ordinary people like us, people who love their children. There is absolute no sense of violence between them. And in fact, one thing I would say, when I was going to Darfur, of course, regularly, I would find I would return behaving rather better. Mm. I think people, when they have less, are more generous. They understand what it's like to really struggle. They are incredibly polite. And when you have very little, I think your dignity is something that you have naturally.
Yes.
There are very gracious people, the Darfurians.
Sure, they are. I mean, I've met one or two of them. They do seem lovely. The population itself, however, a significant proportion are displaced as refugees into neighbouring Chad. Yeah, by and large.
Yes.
And there are very large camps in Chad.
Oh, but huge camps within Darfur itself. Vast. Just outside El Fasher, you've got 40,000 in one camp and 40,000 in Abu Shouk and 40,000 in As-Salam, which is close.
Aid is being delivered in these camps. Is that...?
Not as much as it was.
Right.
It's really cut back. Huge problems with water with them all. I've been watching carefully to see. There's a real sense of deprivation in the camps now building up. One of the things, though, that I must say, it's changes. We live by the visual images we get on television. Mm. And of course, originally, it was very much a tented camp. Huge area. Outside El Fasher, the regional capital. And when I first went there, it was frightening. All you could hear was the wind. The wind blows across the flat plains of Darfur. You mentioned about the Sahara encroaching, the desert encroaching. Mm. Yes, it is. Desert creep is a real problem. And you would have the sand crashing against these plastic tents non-stop. Mm. Now the camps look settled. They've built their little huts, they've put fences around where they can and so on. And one of the things we've been doing, actually, and it's so exciting, I can't tell you. You know, when you're under the blistering sun with no shade in a straw hut, the huts are made from the stalks of the millet, which is the basic crop, straw huts. So, of course, the sand blows through, there's no ceiling and so on. And what we've been doing, I don't know if you know, is planting trees. I'm passionate about trees, which actually not only stop the desert creep, but of course create shade. Mm. And one of the lovely things, we were there once and we saw birds above the trees. And my partner who's there with me said, "Oh, I wonder if they'll eat the eggs of the birds." Mm. And the Darfurians who were with us said, "Oh no, I don't think so." They are. Isn't that wonderful? It's a new source of food, having the eggs from the birds that are nesting in the trees now.
Well, birds.
In Victorian England, yeah. we had pigeon yes, lofts yes. in order to have a food source, of course.
Yes, yes. Maybe we really need to tell people about the work of Kids for Kids, because we've been talking about the tragedy in Darfur. We've been talking about, well, it's a tragedy in Sudan, because there are many areas of need, but Darfur is a particular
One thing I would
focus.
Like to say, and I think it's a really important message, the media has gone silent about Darfur. I mean, this is why I was so desperate to accept your invitation,
right,
actually, William.
Right.
The media has gone silent. The aid agencies, as you probably know, 16 of them were expelled from the country. When you haven't got the aid agencies there, you've lost their publicity machines, which are vast. And therefore, there's no pressure to actually talk about Darfur at all. And the government of Sudan does keep people away from the region. I'm not able to go myself at the moment. Mm. What is tragedy is that the violence has actually increased this year dramatically. Far from the problems going away, it has really, really increased. And the indirect effects of that, we all know the immediate, the horrendous direct effects of violence. What people don't think about is the long-term indirect effects. And that has shown itself in malnourishment in children in every single village. Mm. Last year, I had 18 villages on a short list for me to choose. We adopt whole villages, and I'll explain it to you, and we put in a whole package of help. This year, there were 36 villages desperate for our help. And what was shocking is every single one reports children dying from starvation, severe malnutrition, they call it, starvation, or malaria. Completely preventable, both of them. Now, this year, we're stretching ourselves. I'm desperate for more help. I was determined we would help as many as we can, and we're adopting 8 villages this year. Mm. It's a stretch. Goodness knows how many we'll be able to adopt next year. But that brings the total villages that Kids for Kids has helped so far, or continues to help, to 78. Mm. Now, in those villages, what is amazing, there is no malnutrition. Mm. Now, that alone makes can you imagine? Can you imagine holding your baby and watching the baby starve? You know, it's beyond words, isn't it? So you have to do something. And what is, it is a real privilege is that it was purely by chance. I went to Darfur when I visited Alistair back in 2001 and said I wanted to see how children were living. And we went to Darfur. In fact, we saved the children. And we were travelling around, and we were 90 miles away from the regional capital. It was March, which is still spring, but it was severe drought. And we came across, my hair on the back of my neck still goes up when I think about it, a little 9-year-old who was walking 7 hours across the desert to fetch water for his family. Now, you can't begin to think of it. Now, if you can't do something about it, you could cry, but you walk away. What is shocking is that you can do something about it, and I'm proving it. There's water underground in Darfur. We all know the largest aquifer, the water reservoir, the largest in Africa is under Darfur. Why isn't the world actually therefore saying top priority, we will make certain every single village has water?
Yes, yes.
Now, children are still walking 20 miles across the desert for water while I sit here. And it's, you know, I go cold at the thought of it. I'm absolutely thrilled because we're putting in 13 hand pumps at this moment. Mm. We repair hand pumps. You know what's shocking? Where there are hand pumps, many of them stand idle. The people themselves don't have the money to do it. I mean, how can they have money when they're subsistence farmers in a region where there is no assistance for anything?
Stand idle because there's some minor technical fault.
Yeah, We train water committees so that they have a chance of repairing, of servicing at the hand pumps. But sometimes you need, you know, you need to pay for your plumber or whoever to come out. And these are priorities that are actually inexcusable that they're not provided. That's the absolute first priority. And then when I sat with the villagers and talked about their lives, it was so, the young girls, they marry quite young, as you can imagine, terrified of childbirth. And I said to them, well, what help is there? Well, there is no health care in the villages. Now imagine that, I've got a plaster on my finger. You wouldn't have a plaster. I would lose my fingernail, that's tricky. I met an old lady who had a piece of material across her thumb. And I said to her, oh, what's happened to your thumb? And she moved it. And the whole thumb had been eaten away. And what it needed, it was a fungal infection. What it needed was a simple steroid cream. Now, with childbirth, I said, oh, what happens? And everybody wants to spare me upset. So they say, oh, we are very lucky, they said, in this one village. We have a traditional birth attender. Oh, what does she do? I said. Well, she is someone who has survived childbirth. And so what she does is encourages, helps. And if the baby is stuck, then it's a rope delivery. That's what you do. Now, can you imagine how many young girls' lives are ruined with fistula? When there's obstructed labour, fistula is the outcome. If you survive, the baby will not survive. You cannot live with someone with who's incontinent in a hot country. It's not possible. So a young girl's life, 15, 16, 17, could be ruined at that stage. Well, I'm very proud that we actually have 40 young village girls in training at the moment as village midwives. We've trained, I think it's 148 already across the villages. We put in two in each village to support each other. If we did just that, it would be pretty good. But in fact, when I met that little nine-year-old, I went to find his mother because I actually thought, how could a mother let her nine-year-old do that walk? If he was doing that walk in March, he wouldn't survive the summer. So I went to find her. I suppose I was very English and, you know, a bit embarrassed thinking about it. But anyway, I went back and found her, and it was really touching. They were camping away from the village. You couldn't do that now because of the violence. Then it was safe to do so. She was camping away because she had three precious possessions, and that was three goats, little goats like mine. And what was amazing was the little boy's water was not only keeping his younger brothers and sisters alive, but also the three goats, and their milk was his only source, or the children's only source, of protein, minerals and vitamins. And when we said about Darfurians being a wonderful race, I'll never forget this, I was the honoured guest. I was the only lady coming in a big 4x4. And she immediately gave us the only thing she had, which was the bowl of goat's milk. Can you imagine? And I had to pretend I was drinking it to accept and to, you know, and I realised actually, I mean, my first thought had been, oh, I could have, you know, I could raise money to do, you know, myself, to put in a hand pump in that little boy's village. It's actually £4,500 for a hand pump. That's nothing when you think what that does. But when I my lips touched that milk, I realised actually, if I could help provide goats, three wasn't enough for the family. If I could provide more goats for families like hers, then that's what I should do. So the money that I hadn't actually raised my own for the hand pump, I actually came back to England and actually put towards raising awareness. And it was amazing. In the first 6 months, we raised £54,000.
Good heavens.
And I'm not very trusting. I went back 6 months later to check that it was spent properly. I was absolutely, now I'm afraid all our goats are branded, and I see photographs and I check them in, I'm sent photographs of when they're bought in the market, I then see them branded, they're vaccinated and so on. But at that stage, I went back to the village to count the goats, and it was very special, and to see the hand pumps and so on. And then, of course, as you know, we now do a whole package of
things. Hence the name Kids for Kids.
Yeah, baby kids. Baby kids for four-legged. Two-legged for four-legged.
Yeah, gosh. The other round. And the hand pumps, I mean, obviously, you're having to put in a drilling rig to drill down, and that's the real cost,
yeah.
isn't it?
Yeah. It is. Yeah. And it's also that we actually provide spare parts and training. There are lots of basic things that one can do. For example, teaching hygiene. That's one of the things we teach the water committees. And we also fund first aid workers who are with no healthcare. You need to have people who understand hygiene, who understand how to sew up a wound. Our big philosophy is actually to prevent small problems becoming catastrophes. Because something that to you and I would be simple, we'd go to our doctor, we'd get an antibiotic, we'd go to hospital, we'd have our leg properly set. Yeah. When you're in the middle of a village, you are, if you're lucky, you're taken to hospital on a stretcher between two donkeys. Can you imagine? Or you ride on a donkey. Well, if you're in labour and it's obstructed labour, what chance do you have? Very little.
So yours is the only major international charity that's working in Darfur now, or not? Well, I mean,
actually, all these years, it's now almost 15, we're the only organisation in the whole world that it was actually created specifically to help the children of Darfur and specifically to provide sustainable help. Right from the start, it was obvious to me. I live in Dorking. How could I run projects in Darfur? No. What I needed to do was to enable the villagers to run the projects themselves. So we're right at the moment in the process of training the communities in bookkeeping, in accountability and so on, so that we will get their foot on the first step of that ladder, but then it's up to the communities to run the projects themselves. And what's wonderful is that we've discovered this wonderful way of encouraging people to do it. It's very difficult, you know, to run projects. Your life, when you're walking for water, you're walking for firewood, you're walking to market, you know, everything. You've got miles and miles and miles to go. It takes forever to do. So to add extra work on is very difficult. And also to expect people to work for the whole community is challenging. But what we're doing is sort of rewards. And when a village has rotated their goats, because I'm quite mean, I don't give goats, I lend them. I don't actually believe in charity. I believe in helping people to help themselves. That's the key. And so after 2 years, they built up a little flock. And then they pass on the same number of goats they've received, which is six, they pass them on to another family. And then after 2 years, that family does the same. And so we started by lending 10% of the poorest families goats, but as poverty became worse and worse, we've built it up to 15% now. So you can do your sums when, you know, how long will it take for a whole village to benefit from just one goat loan? It's incredible, absolutely incredible. And do you know, the case studies we've got of the effectiveness is extraordinary. I mean, we've got one woman, it's just lovely, in a newsletter I just put out, which her name was Khaltoum, and she had her goats in 2005. And after all this time, she passed on her goats. She's still got 40. She's doing really well with her goats. Two of her children, she's paid for the education. Two of her children, a boy and a girl, are both at university in Al Fasha now. Now, that was beyond her wildest dreams. I mean, literally, and there are many families across the villages who do that. And what we're doing now is when a village has done their rotations well, we'll reward them. So as long as I have the money. And we've just finishing our fourth kindergarten. Isn't that incredible, William? Children going to school whose mothers have, well, they begged me for the last 15 years for kindergartens. I never thought it would happen.
And so people are coming back to the villages now because so many have been driven out, haven't they? Well, I mean, just by the fighting and not just by the fighting, but also by the famine that caused by the global warming or whatever causes the
desertification.
I can't even pronounce that word. Desertification.
Can you spell it?
Yes. but the Sahara or whatever moving in. So many have been driven out. They are coming back to the villages?
That's what's completely amazing in the Kids for Kids villages. Our villages are growing. There's a village called Azagafa that was 3,000 people. It's now, well, last year it was 5,000 people, and the leader tells me that it's growing again. And what's wonderful, and it's such a privilege, it's nothing to do with me. People from the IDP camps, the internally displaced people, will talk to the village leaders and say, may we move in? And the village then as a community provides land, helps them build a hut, but they can't do much more than that. And what we've done is to devise a package which will actually help them link into the community by joining what we call our animal loan committee. We provide them with a goat loan, and then their six goats need to be then passed on to a family within the village. So it links them. So those two families are already friends. They're looking after the same animals. And we then provide them with the other things that we do. For a family, you know, when you go into a hut in Darfur, it's devastating. It's empty, the sand on the ground. And you know how sand flies, diseases are in the sand. Yes. There are maybe two single beds made out of wood and rope. There may be a tobe, you know, that clothes the ladies wear, that they're using as a sheet, maybe. And you say, where are the children sleeping? Oh, they'll sleep there on the sand. No mosquito nets. And when you look for possessions, there are none. There are none. And actually what we're doing, and it's a great privilege, we are actually providing a donkey. That's the 4x4 of Darfur. We provide a donkey. I'm actually considering working out how much are saddles, because we wouldn't provide for just one or two people. We do it as a project, so it's, you know, across each community. So now, because people are so impoverished, should we provide saddles? I think we should. We provide two blankets for the children. Because one of the things that I was finding was a lot of children are dying from chest infections. You know, when you're malnourished, any germ is difficult to fight. And the nights in Darfur are bitterly cold at times. I mean, I've been there and I've worn a hat and I've had my nose red in the morning. when there are no blankets, they huddle together. So we provide two blankets for each household. Oh, and a wonderful thing, one lady said to me, you know, now that I've got household assets, two blankets, I'm listened to in the village meetings. Think of that.
I mean, just talking about, because it is something that bothers us in Britain. Many of the refugees we're getting here are from Darfur. Many of the refugees crossing through Libya, good heavens, help them, and then going across the Mediterranean and coming into Europe are from Darfur. I mean, a significant proportion. And they're coming up into Europe and then waiting in Calais and desperately trying to get across to Britain. That is of itself a tragedy. What should we be doing? I mean, there's this whole ethical issue. Let's take it from, you have the camps in Chad. Are they part of the problem or are they part of the answer? If we take refugees here in the United Kingdom, are we part of the problem or are we part of the answer? I mean, should we be? I noticed a statement from Al-Azhar about Syrian refugees, or at least about refugees from the Middle East in general. And they were critical of the West for taking so many refugees because Al-Azhar was saying, we're contributing to the ethnic cleansing of the Middle East. Is there an ethical issue here? What are we failing to do? Should we be delivering much more aid in the region? And are we not, by taking refugees, whether it's in camps in Chad or whether it's across the Mediterranean and on into Europe, are we actually part of the problem or part of the answer? I mean, just help me a little with this big moral question.
I have to be horrendous here and say both. Of course it's both. I think there is also, one needs to really differentiate between types of refugees as well. I think if it's victims, people who are likely to be victims of torture, who are known to be at great risk if they go back to their own country, then we have a moral obligation to, to give them refuge. And I can't imagine any person in any country, anywhere in the world, who would challenge that. But of course, you've got to actually check that that is the case, if you can. To send someone back to known imprisonment and worse would be, to me, just unacceptable. But when you look at others, and it's easy, you know, these terrible labels you give people, economic refugees, and that's what we're talking about. But when you use the word economic, one tends to think in terms of the West, of banks, of finances and so on. I don't believe it's like that at all. I believe it's that you have families who literally cannot survive unless one of them leaves to earn money elsewhere. And the difficulty these days is that Darfurians to go to Khartoum, they're not being welcomed in Khartoum. I mean, I know that Darfurian students have been targeted in the university, according to the reports. So if I were a mother, that's how I judge things. If I was a mother in Darfur, I have my children to look after, and my elder son says, I need to go and earn money for you, mother. This is what I need to do. Then I'd, for the love of the whole family and of him, I would have to say, go, but God bless you and keep you safe. And of course, then what happens is that they hear of, rather like Dick Whittington, of the streets of gold of London are paved in gold. And compared to Darfur, they are. And so I can quite understand how people would like to come to England. We all know that if once you're here, we do provide free healthcare and education and so on, and that's wonderful. But I think it's what I've already explained. The big problem is that people cannot support their families in their own countries. And in Darfur, conditions have got worse, and they've got worse despite the presence of countless aid agencies over the past 12 years.
Well, you see the presence, but are they present in Darfur? They're present outside,
well,
really?
Now, of course, there are very few there. And I think the big problem is that we, as rich comparative nations who are providing aid, are not taking care how our aid is delivered. For example, DFID, if you're actually looking at...
That's the British government aid agencies.
And they are the same as aid agencies all over, that people, if you are delivering aid, I believe that you actually have a duty to monitor how it's given and to evaluate its worth. Because actually you have a duty to the donors, to the taxpayers, to whoever. I feel I have a real duty to people who actually support us, whether you're donating me one goat or you're donating me a kindergarten, I have a duty to actually provide what you believe you're funding. And I believe the same with governments. If the government funding is being given as aid to people, you actually need to look at the long-term benefit. There have been billions of dollars spent in Darfur, in the camps. But when you look at it, it's as if they've poured that money into the sand. Yes, lives have been saved, but they haven't been enabled to go back to their own places. So you need peace process. You must have security. Without security, what can you do? The mandate for UNAMID was pathetic. They needed a real mandate to create peace.
UNAMID, the United Nations Assistant Mission in Darfur?
African mission in Darfur. You know, but it was the United Nations who gave them the mandate, you know, how they should act. And unfortunately, their hands have been curtailed. What they do has been curtailed right from the start. And if only the international community right from the start had said, no, we need to do more now. Right now. You know, we were in Darfur, my son and I, when the violence first started, broke out.
Yes.
And when we went to Khartoum, we talked to people to actually say, this is happening, and no one listened. And of course, it exploded. And I believe we need, United Nations, the world, needs to settle peace, help the government to settle peace, with a serious effort. you know, just to send an ambassador down who comes back and says, yes, there's a problem, or to send a special representative down, what do they achieve?
And that's the problem, isn't it? The world attention span with the Middle East in chaos, you look at it. I mean, Libya, Libya is right next door to Sudan and is in a miserable state.
And people are talking now about, you know, youngsters going to Sudan and then going on from Khartoum. We know there have been medics who have done this. You know, you need to create the way of life that will enable people to want to stay in their homes so the young men are not vulnerable. If you were a young man now, William, in Calais, and you cannot get to England, and France doesn't want you, and someone comes and promises help to you and your family, what be your answer? It's a very difficult one, and I think what we have to do as the international community is to A, create the state in your own country that enables you to want to stay there. You need to create peace, and you need to actually check how you are spending your money. I didn't finish telling you about what happens to aid agencies. Their idea, for example, is a very good one. Let's get women together, empower the women, because they will help the families, perhaps more than the men, though the men I come across in Darfur are as keen on their families as you are of yours.
Yes.
And to empower them, though, give them a means of a livelihood, and then go back. But how do they judge the success of that course? Mm. Actually, they judge it by how many people attend the course. Now, you are paid to go, you're given incentive to go, you're a per diem, you're fed during the day. You would go on any course. Mm. But would you take that knowledge back to your village? Probably not. Not unless you were given, somebody came to help you, put what you've learnt into practice.
Mm.
Bear in mind, most of the women, 98% of the women are illiterate in Darfur. So you can't only just teach them once, I'm learning this. We teach them animal husbandry, but we need to go back to actually check that they've understood and they're putting it into practice and can afford to put it into practice. You know, organisations need to take much more care in how they're delivering aid.
So we need more responsibility from the international community. We need more responsibility in terms of aid and in terms of the peace effort and in terms of handling the refugee crisis. Just to come back to that one issue again, I mean, we say a substantial proportion of these young men crossing, bless their hearts, crossing the Mediterranean, I mean, it's a terrible journey, are Darfurian. We're talking, what's that mean, 10% or?
I don't know the percentage, I must admit.
But it is.
I myself have actually talked to Darfurians in Calais, you know, and you see them walking around. You know, I mean, it's how they live, I do not know.
Yes, we've just seen those camps from the side of the road. We were driving into France and it's astonishing, astonishing, that sort of squalid, well, vast tent city in the scrubland and with this razor wire between the road and
tell me, how tents. Could you even get them back to their own country? You know, these people who are there. You cannot get where you want to go, so what are we going to do with them?
Yes,
and that's what needs to be resolved. So there are many things, but my belief in the way that I've run Kids for Kids is to address things right at grassroots, to help people at grassroots. It's slow. It's slow. Mm. But I can't believe in 15 years we've done as much as we can. Our trees are now huge. Seedlings that, I mean, I literally saw as seeds, are now vast trees with foliage. Mm. And they are providing a supplementary income for people.
It's so important.
Isn't that incredible?
Encroachment of the desert and so on. I mean,
and I think that's it. You can't solve everything. But what I think is a shame with Darfur is that the world started to try and do something and then it's turned its back. And I think that's you shouldn't give up. I don't give up.
So we need people like you. The trouble is our attention span, isn't it? I mean, we just look around and then you see Syria. And your heart bleeds. And now Yemen, and your heart bleeds for them. If not the Middle East, it's Nepal. I mean, we're in a world full of tragedy, and people's attention span is limited. And it shouldn't be. We need to remind them. It's so good that you do remind them about Darfur.
You say that about people. Actually, what's amazing, because there's no publicity now about Darfur, it's very difficult to get new supporters.
But what is incredible is that last year our income had crept up, not down. I was expecting it to have gone down. It had actually gone up because our supporters have seen over the years what we're achieving and they have stuck with us. Now that, so I don't agree with you that our attention span is short. I think the journalists feel that we need new impetus each time, move away, move away. Actually, people want to know, what is it that you're achieving? I've got a friends event I talk about at my house in a couple of weeks' time, where I will have a huge, far too many people for the house, people there, where I'll be able to tell them what we have been doing in the last year. And people want to know. Now, I would suggest that there should be accountability to the people who donate aid, the ordinary people, to say, this is what we've done this year for you. And to do it in a meaningful way.
Do you get government aid? I mean, no you don't. So you're entirely...
I rely on individuals to give me a goat.
Right. So it's interesting because the big organisations, government are... Like in Britain, we're talking about Dovid, our aid group. They are reluctant to fund smaller charities as a general rule. And this is not unique to Britain. It's common to many governments.
It's hard work. You know, I mean, I tried, actually, I didn't want to set up a charity. I mean, I've done one before and I know what hard work it is. And I tried to fund the projects through Save the Children, then through Practical Action. Didn't work. Because it needs people who will take the time to get it right. No. I mean, I've got the most amazing... You realise that it's not... I haven't got any expat British person working on the projects. It's solely run by people in Sudan for their own people. And their heart is in it. You know, I mean, we have... My project manager, Dr. Salim, is a vet. He goes himself to check on our animals. Our project officer, Hassan, is absolutely fantastic. He's always coming up with ideas for me that, you know, what about this, Patricia? Shall we do this? And then he'll nudge me if I haven't done something. You know, quite right too.
Well, we'll try and put up try and put up a strap for Kids for Kids. Your website is www. What?
Kids for Kids. That's kids, F-O-R, kids. So... four-legged kids for two-legged kids, right. kidsforkids.org.uk.
Okay.
So we'll try and
get a strap up on the program because it would be good that people know in case they want to help.
William, you know, you've mentioned Yemen, you've mentioned other countries. What I'm doing in Darfur, my dream, is that it should be copied in other countries. I can't multiply myself, but hey, you must know other people. You must know other people. Who would actually take the time and trouble to introduce this type of project to people in different parts of the third world. The key is to sit down as we are and to literally learn about each other's lives and then say, well, would this help you? And, oh, yes, that would work. So that's why it's goats, not sheep. Because sheep will not survive in the winter. That's suitable for Darfur.
Absolutely.
It would be something else somewhere else.
It would be something else, but it is, in a sense,
the
ideology, if you like, the concept of delivering aid in the villages is ideal for war-torn areas because you look
no,
at...
No, not just war-torn areas.
Well...
It's particularly important in war-torn areas. One of the tragedies I found, the obvious organisation in the UK would be WaterAid to help with hand pumps with water. But when I went to them, they said, oh, we don't help in areas that are conflicts driven. That's when you really need it.
Because of course it is, yes.
Walking a distance when you're at risk of attack is just impossible.
Yes.
That's not...
And you look at, like a country like Syria, for instance, where water is such a problem now in the villages, in the towns, even in Aleppo lately. But water and then you have got the increase in diseases like polio. You've got all these problems about food supplies, electricity supplies and so on. And many of the solutions actually need to be delivered locally in the country. And that's what not...
And delivered by local people.
Yeah.
Run by the locals. But again, you need to take time to find out who are the real tribal leaders. You need their buy-in. If the people of influence in the villages are happy to do this, then, I mean, we had a village way back, back in 2002. We went to a village, we sat with the village leaders, and I said, one of the things we wanted to do was to train two midwives. which meant the two girls had to go to El Fasha, to the teaching hospital. And the village leader said, oh, no, I can't let my women do that. So we said, well, we can't then help your village. That village now is one of our villages because the leaders sat, talked, saw what was happening in other Kids for Kids villages and came to us and said, we really want to empower our women now. We really want to join with this. Mm. And they run the project, not me. And it's really terrific. People learn.
Oh, how magnificent. Yeah. That really is a joyous thing that you're doing this great work. Thank you so much. I think it's so wonderful. Sudan is such a wonderful country, so precious, and been through so much.
I'm dying to go back.
Well, you shall, God willing.
Yeah, I'm missing my friends and my goats.
Oh, bless you. Well, if we have any influence, we'll all of us lobby for your return. And thank you so much for all the wonderful work you do. It's amazing, outstanding, and glorious. Bless you.
Well, I'm very, very lucky. I really am. It's a real privilege.
Well, bless your heart. We haven't quite finished our interview. We have a little footnote, but thank you so much for being our guest. Welcome back. It's here we are. 2 minutes ago, we were talking. Oh, here we are again. And it's the book. This is a lovely little piece in our interviews, and it's become a tradition here on ANN with the English Hours that we discuss a book. And you've brought a book.
I brought a real book. It's not a Kindle. It's a real book. I love the feel of books.
Yes. And tell us about the book.
The Byerly Turk.
The Byerly Turk.
Ah, now you're not a horse lover in that case.
Well, I don't.
You see, I not only love goats and donkeys, I love horses. And I used to ride a lot and so on. And the Byerly Turk is one of probably the most famous horse in the entire world because he is the founder of our beautiful English thoroughbreds, which of course have spread around the world. You probably know the Godolphin stallion.
Yes, I know. Because
but the Byerly Turk is literally, it says, the first thoroughbred. And it was back in 1678, I think. Absolutely extraordinary. So you know that he lived, and he was born in Turkey. He was a fighting stallion, and then he made in many battles. I mean, you know these big horses, scary. Can you imagine if you have somebody's on a stallion and it's pouring out at you? You know, shod hooves. It survived the battles unscathed, and eventually ended up in England. This is why we are so fond of the Byerly Turk. Ended up in England, won one of the most famous races, the King's Race, something like that. Absolutely extraordinary, and was then used for breeding. And it's his bloodline that is now winning at Ascot.
Because the thoroughbred racehorse. There were originally four bloodlines, weren't there?
That's right. That's right.
One of whom was Godolphin, and then
the Dahlia. I can't remember the fourth, but the Byerly was the first in 1680.
The first
I think,
of the four.
It? Yep. Yeah.
And
absolutely.
All British horses, race horses, are drawn from
and
these
thoroughbreds
bloodlines.
Across the world. Right. I mean, literally anyone with thoroughbred blood in them, they will trace them back to this amazing creature. And what Jeremy James has done, he's actually, I think, part horse. He's travelled across Britain, across Europe, across Turkey with two horses. So he understands horses. And then his research has been amazing. I mean, it's been from Oxford libraries to Turkish libraries to talking to people. He's unearthed four portraits of that horse. Can you imagine? Painted back then. And there are still four portraits in existence of this particular horse.
So this is an actual historical work or a novel? What is it?
It's a novel, but based on fact.
Right.
I mean, it's actually, you know, some things he's had to presume. But there's enough evidence that it took a lot of digging out, enough evidence to actually say that book you could take as pretty well what's almost certain to have happened as to how this extraordinary creature actually ended up in England and has such an incredible destiny.
This is the story of the horse. This is actually, written from the perspective.
No, it's not from the perspective of the horse.
No,
it's no. It's not Black Beauty in the first person.
Well, I just wondered. Yes, we have this for the our viewers. There is a children's book called Black Beauty that's very popular in the. Yeah.
And it makes us all cry.
Yes, about a
but
horse.
This made me cry too.
But it did. So this is the story, I mean, the life of the horse, but in a fictional work.
Yes, but as it says, this is the true story of the most remarkable horse in history. Now, well, listen to this. The Bali Turk was born in a humble stable in the Balkans in 1678, but went on to become one of the finest fighting horses in the Ottoman cavalry, finally captured by the English at the Siege of Buda. He was ridden across Central Europe. Isn't this amazing? And this, the author has done exactly this. Then won the King's Plate. That was the race. Mm. Racing in Northern Ireland on his way to fight at the Battle of the Boyne. Well, you've
Good
heard of
Lord.
That.
Good Lord, yes.
His luck never ran out. Unmarked, undamaged, he returned to Yorkshire to become the first foundation sire of the thoroughbred line. Could you think of a better historical novel than that? And for someone who loves animals, I think that has to
and
be
this
the
is
best.
What we call, I mean, we've always called these horses Arabs, haven't we? They are these.
Yeah. There's Arab blood, and you can have purebred Arabs. They're much smaller. They have dish noses, beautiful creatures, absolutely breathtaking. Mm. I've never actually been to Arab racing in England, but it's on one of my tick boxes that, you know, one of the things I'd like to do. But I used to ride a little Arab, well, cross Arab, when I was young. I'm really passionate about him.
Wow. So this is the story of what we call the first, is the first thoroughbred.
Yeah. And it will be these horses that people would ride hunting, that will look at the Grand National, those huge jumps. You need a heart as brave as this horse's to be able to jump those jumps. And you know, you might do it once. Would you go back and do it again? No, but the horses will. Mm. They're incredible. So although I'm a huge pacifist, and this is a fighting stallion, I think, you know, good for him.
See, so this is by Jeremy James. And wonderful, wonderful. And published by, where are we?
Falcon, I think it is, yeah.
Falcon Books? Let's see.
Merlin Unwin.
Oh, Merlin. Okay.
It's a Merlin, not a Falcon. Merlin Unwin there.
All right.
But, so. I really recommend it. Absolutely fantastic. And friends who've read it, I've been lending it. This is why it looks a bit sort of battered.
Yes.
And I've lent it to so many friends. And most books that I lend and... You know, please keep it. This one I want back.
Oh,
you know,
wow,
so if you'd like to read it, William,
we'll have to get our own copy.
I was brought up never to write in a book, but I have actually written my name in. I want this book back.
Okay.
I will read it again.
Well, hopefully our viewers can find it. It must be on Amazon or
it is on Amazon.
100%.
Yeah.
The Bali Turk, The True Story of the First Thoroughbred by Jeremy James, published by Merlin Unwin. Thank you, Patricia. Thank you for being our guest. And thank you for bringing this precious book to our attention.
Thank you.
Bless you. Many, many thanks.
Thank you, William. Bye.